everybody, Super Rhino 57 here with another mod tutorial. I know it's been about 2 weeks, and I'm sorry for that. I was researching another mod, but anyways, the reason you are here is to learn about this very awesome mod. And in case you can't tell by what's behind me, I am doing thermal expansion today. These are all the boxes themselves are called caches. They're all different types, and starting with regular basic cache, hardened, reinforced, resonant, and creative mode. But all these things you see on them are other things added by this mod. So let's go ahead and jump into the TARDIS and take a look around. Okay. You see, I got a bunch of stuff set up in here. But the biggest thing about thermal expansion is it adds a bunch of new machines and automation. And I've got a bunch of them laid out here. I don't think I've got all of them. I got as much as I could, and I did a little setup over there to show them work. And you can hear my baby girl in the background making a lot of noise. Sorry about that. She's really excited today. She's playing with mama. Anyways, as you see in parentheses beside each machine, it says resonant. That's because one thing this mod adds in is tiered machines. So go in here. They all say resonant because the way you make them, you have to have a machine frame, and the recipe tiers up. So let me pull this up here. Oops, if I can spell. Here we go. Machine frame basic. You see, it just requires tin gear, glass, iron, and tin gear is just four pieces of tin and an iron. Now, if we move up from basic to the hardened, you need the basic frame plus Electrum and Invar. And then moving on to reinforced, you need the hardened to make it. You also need hardened glass and Signalum. So it does tier up depending on, early game, late game, but each one allows more customization, faster operations. And so these machines I'm showing right here are all resonant, which is top of the line. So this is the best they can get. But I just want to show you some of this stuff. You got the redstone furnace. Most people already know what the redstone furnace is. It's just an enhanced electrical furnace. It runs on power instead of fuel. Got some beef up here. I'll throw the stack in there and see how much faster it cooks. So it is an upgrade from the basic furnace. So maybe later on down the game, you go ahead and make this so you don't have to stand around waiting for the slow furnace all day. Moving on, we have the pulverizer. Now, the neat thing about the pulverizer is it brings in dusts of ores. As in, type in pulverized, it gives you pulverized versions of all these metals. Why is that beneficial? Well, it's a lot like Tinker's Construct Smeltery. As in, you can throw one ore in here, and it'll pulverize it into two dusts. See, now I got two Ardite dusts. And go over here to the furnace. I'll pull these out. Throw these two dusts in here. So now that one ore has turned into two ingots. So it allows for ore multiplication. Now, another thing about thermodynamics is the configuration, the automation. You can literally make them transport from machine to machine side by side. So for here, I'm going to tell it to put the output to out the left side. And over here, I'm going to tell it to draw from the right side. So now I will throw a single cobalt in here, and nothing showed up. But you saw the machine light up because it went ahead and outputted over here. Of course, I know I should have put the pulverizer over here, but you get the point. That just shows how customizable, yeah, how much you can change things and configure it to how you like it. It also adds in different ducts. Not duck as in quack quack, but I mean, this one is a resonant fluix duct. It allows the transfer of energy. And I've got a battery over here that's powering all these machines. But you'll see over here, I've also got item ducts and fluid ducts. So, anyways, moving on. You have the sawmill. And what the sawmill does is it takes any wooden object and reduces it to its basic or more basic components such as the planks. And in case of the bookshelf, it also gives you a second output of books. So neat little thing, trying to harvest books. I've never used it in my personal worlds, but it could be beneficial. Anyways, moving on. Induction smelter. Now, in order to get to the in or in order to better understand the induction smelter, I need to use my pulverizer. Reason being, change that. I got lead and obsidian over here. The induction smelter adds in more complex items, and I'll show you what I mean. Also, the pulverizer has two outputs right here. So, as you can see, I've got lead over here, and it's putting obsidian over here. Uh-oh, I'll be right back. And I'm back. Sorry about that. My baby girl was whining, and she wanted some crackers. Anyways, as I was saying, it adds in these additional items, such as you got some recipes here for ores to smelt them down to their ingot form. Much like the pulverizer, it does a duplication effect, but it's a bit more complex because you have to have catalysts, such that in this case you need sand. Here you got pyrothium dust, but see with lead and obsidian, it gives you hardened glass. So I'll go ahead and throw that in there. But it also gives you secondary outputs. In this case, you got rich slag, you got regular slag. Cinnabar is also an output effect. And in this case, you can use cinnabar on copper, gives you three copper ingots plus a gold ingot. And so the induction smelter does help with some aspects, such as getting additional ores and stuff, but it is a much late game because cinnabar is a bit more difficult. In order to get cinnabar, sorry, you need to smelt redstone ore. Or gold, see, redstone ore gives you 25% chance, gold ore only gives you 5% chance. Oh, there is a cinnabar ore. I forgot about that. I think it's fairly difficult to find though, and requires a fluid transposer with jello cryothium. That's pretty late game stuff. Jello cryothium is a in-game fluid slash dust. It's fairly difficult. You see, you got snowballs, blizz powder. In order to get blizz powder, you have to find a mob called the Blizz, basically a snow version of the Blaze, and he drops blizz powder. Or if you have enough redstone, you can make blizz powder by destabilized redstone in a snowball. And all the destabilized redstone is just putting. Sorry, lost my train of thought. Putting redstone in a magma crucible. I'll show you that coming up. For some reason, this isn't wanting to. Oh, a glitch. That was weird. But you see, hardened glass. Anyways, moving on. This is the magma crucible I was just telling you about. And I have cryothium dust here. And I believe I've already got this one. Yeah, I've got this one configuration. Usually, when you have the magma crucible, you also have a fluid transposer. The magma crucible takes dusts or certain dusts and other objects and turns it into the fluid form, like destabilized redstone out of regular redstone, or energized glowstone from glowstone. But in this case, I've got cryothium dust, which is going to give me jellied cryothium, and I've got it outputting to a fluid transposer. Now, what a fluid transposer does is you can take buckets and throw them in here and either take fluid out, or you can put a bucket of water in here, just for example, and it'll take the water out of the bucket and store it in its own little tank. So, say you have a bunch of fluid tanks back here and you have a couple buckets, you can just throw them in here and let it automatically output to each individual tank depending on, organization. But in this case, thermal expansion, sorry. I think I said thermal dynamics earlier. That's an add-on mod for this actual mod. But anyways, thermal expansion also adds in what's called a florb. And what a florb is it holds 1,000 millibuckets, just like a regular bucket. But it's a portable, not portable, a throwable form. So in this case, I have a florb of jelly cryothium, and I'm just gonna chuck it. And wherever it landed, it drops a source. Jelly cryothium is a very dense liquid, so it doesn't pool like water and lava and all that. It just falls down to the lowest possible area. But as you can see, jelly cryothium is extremely cold. It leaves snow around. Little fun fact for you. So yeah, that's the fluid transposer and the magma crucible. If you have fluid in here, as you just saw, you can put some sort of container in here, and it'll automatically fill it, whether it's tanks or, you know, from some other mod, a tank or anything. Any kind of fluid container can go in here. You just toggle between empty and fill, and it'll either pull fluid out or put fluid in. And over here we have the igneous extruder. Yes, sounds weird. Now, I don't really see much purpose in this, but I just figured I'd show y'all anyways. The igneous extruder, you put lava in here, you put water in here, and it'll either output cobblestone, regular stone, or obsidian. Your choice. So I'm just going to turn that. Also, there's redstone control. You can leave it to where it ignores redstone, or it requires a redstone signal. Another awesome customizable effect. But you can see it's sitting here mixing it. To make obsidian, it requires 1,000 millibuckets of water and 1,000 millibuckets of lava. Make cobblestone, it literally requires none. As long as you have lava and water in here, it's just going to keep pumping it out, see? And then stone, I believe, requires 1,000 millibuckets of water and no lava. Yes. So I'm just going to just disable that. So yeah, there's something for you. Another thing this mod brings in, dynamos. Basically, these are engines. There's different forms. You have steam dynamo, which just requires heat source and, or not heat source, lava or some form of hot fluid, and water or some form of, you know, cooler fluid, and it will produce steam, and that's how you get power through this. You also have a magmatic dynamo, a compression dynamo. The reactant dynamo, what it does is, it sounds weird, but it uses a alchemy reaction sort of thing, where it requires a liquid fuel as well as a solid catalyst, as it phrases it. The liquid could be something like energized glowstone or destabilized redstone or some other fluids. And then the catalyst has to be something like blaze powder, gunpowder. I think you can use a gas tier and a nether star. But depending on what fluid and what catalyst you use will change how much output it puts out. Or overall, I think they all output 80 RF per tick. But so there's the reactant. The innervation dynamo, I was able to find some stuff on that. Excuse me. The innervation dynamo, what it does is it draws energy from chargeable objects, such as, in this case, a resonant energy cell. And see, it's taking energy out of it. You can also use redstone or redstone blocks, and it'll draw energy from that as well. The compression dynamo, what it does is it uses some type of fuel, like oil, biofuel, or also what's called liquefied coal. And I mentioned that for a reason, you'll find out later. But it's basically liquefied coal, and it needs a coolant like water or gelled cryothium, and it'll output power. Magmatic, a lot like the name sounds, it needs magma. It requires lava or some hot fluid, and it'll output power. And then over here, I believe I mentioned this in my Ender IO mod, and I was mistaken, I do apologize. The Tesseract is from this mod, and what the Tesseract is it is a transportation for fluid, energy, and items. So I can go up here and configure it. Item mode, fluid mode, energy mode. You also have to set a channel, in this case we'll say all. And here we'll put number one, save frequency, set frequency. So now if I go put a Tesseract somewhere else and tell it to transfer all three, and I set it to this frequency, then they'll automatically communicate. Whereas I could have another Tesseract, set it to a different frequency, and it'll never see the network, basically. So it's just a wireless network of transportation. So that's neat. Moving on, we have storage. We have energy cells ranging up. You got the leadstone. As you can see, it holds 400,000 RF. Yeah, RF. Sorry. The hardened energy cell holds 2 million RF. Stepping up, you got the redstone energy cell, holds 20 million RF. And then another step up is the resonant energy cell, which holds 80 million RF. Sorry. And so that's for obviously energy. And then it also adds in these portable tanks. Now, don't let the name fool you. If you break it with fluid inside, let's see here. Let me get a bucket of cryothium. I don't need that anymore. We'll just get rid of these. So I'll take this bucket. There we go. Let me get a pickaxe. Change my game mode. Now, if I use a pickaxe on this tank, you get the fluid inside of it. That's why it's portable. Okay. I was thinking that this was the tank or the mod that if you break the tank with a pickaxe, then it gets rid of all the fluid. There was another mod I played with that did that and really upset me. But you can also take a crescent wrench, shift, right click, and boom. There we go. You stack it on top, and it automatically dispenses to the tank below it. And see, if you watch carefully, there's a blue on top and an orange on bottom of this tank because orange is output, and blue is input. So if I were to take this, oh yeah, sorry. I was trying to fly and realized I wasn't in game mode yet. There we go. There we go. And see, it transported all the way down. So yeah, that's a neat little feature. Anyways, moving on. We have what's called strong boxes. Now, I know that sounds weird. They're just basic chests. But the basic strong box only has 18 spots. Harden has 36, and just keeps stepping up. So that is larger than a normal chest. Yes, there's an enchanting table in here, because the strong box is special, because you can enchant it. So what you do is you take the strong box, I thought I had one in my inventory, sorry. We'll take the resonant, throw it in here, and it gives me a holding one. Now, I wasn't able to find anything in the forums as far as what the enchants do, but another reason the strong boxes are special is because of security. But pretty much, you can set it to where only you can access these chests, or this particular chest. Or you can also have a friends list where, like, a faction is allowed to access this one chest. So if someone raids, they can't enter, if they can't take anything out of this particular chest. So that's the reason strong boxes are special. Anyways, moving on. These are caches. Now, if you've ever played Sky Factory or similar mod packs, then a cache is a lot like, not a barrel, I guess a barrel. I don't know what the word is I'm looking for, but pretty much you can fill it with a large amount of one particular item, and it'll display that one item on the front, so you know exactly what's in each one. In this case, I have a workbench, and in order to empty it, I have to be in regular mode, shift, left click, and it gives me one. If I left click it with an empty hand, it gives me a whole stack. If I right click it, it takes any of the ones in my inventory and automatically fills it. So, see, I can take a bunch of stacks, right click it, shift right click, nothing. Shift left click, give me one. So you can literally just fill this thing up with a large quantity. Let's see. Nope. Sorry, I was trying to do something that I can only do in creative mode. There we go. The reinforced holds 160,000. So that's just a reference, so you can see how these would be beneficial. But moving on, we have the machinist workbench. And what the Machinist Workbench is, it allows you to create schematics. And I'll show you why you need schematics later, here in a few. But you just input a blank schematic, which all you need is paper, some blue dye, some lapis, so, and it'll give you one schematic. It gives you a ghost inventory, so see I've only got 3 obsidian, but it gives you a little ghost icon there, but say I just want obsidian sticks. Okay, so now we've got the recipe in there, click write schematic, boom, there's the schematic. Okay, I'll show you why you need that later on over there. Anyways, autonomous activator. As far as I go, this is one of the more famous machines I am aware of because I played Sky Factory, and you get this, you want to make this really early for automation. And what it does is it acts like the left or right click of a player. So for like farming and stuff, the ores in Sky Factory, you just put a hammer in here and breaks gravel, all kinds of little automation. You just gotta give it power, tell it left click, right click. Okay, and once it breaks the items or gets items, or if you want to automate it, tell it, okay, I want you to draw items from back in the back, output to the side. But a nice little automation feature. The terrain smasher. It will break any block you put in front of it, including obsidian. Which is funny, because the recipe... There's the recipe for it. It's just a piston, 10 gears, Invar pickaxe, and Invar ingots are just made from Invar blend. There we go. Iron and nickel or ferrous metal. And also a pneumatic servo, which is just iron, redstone, and glass. So, really cheap and early recipe. But then all of a sudden you can just put obsidian in front of it and it'll break it for you. So, really neat little feature there for early game. Then you have the nullifier. This is just a basic trash can. You put an item in there, it's gone. It just sends it to oblivion. There's no storage, no nothing, just... I don't need this anymore. Boom. Okay, now for this. Now what this is I set up a little demonstration to give you a better idea of how some of these machines work. And so I've got a lot of automation going on here. What I've got is I have a cache here full of coal. It is pumping coal into these 2 pulverizers. I had to use transfer nodes to pull out of because I didn't want any of the ducts connecting accidentally. Plus I wanted to look more organized and, you know, kind of separate the detail. So just pretend these are item ducts. I do have item ducts in here. And then I've got, I have fluid duct, but they're down here, see? So there's fluid duct. Anyways, I'll show you. So coal pumping into the pulverizer, turning into pulverized coal. Pulverized coal is then getting pumped out into here. It's way too full. I'm going to have to take some of this out. Anyways, so the pulverized coal is getting pumped back into that machine, which is the cyclic assembler, which I didn't include over there. I'm so sorry. The cyclic assembler is what you need the schematic for. You take the schematic, you put it in the cyclic assembler, and in this case I have all the items being pumped in for this particular recipe or schematic, and it will automatically craft what you are looking for. And then I have it pumping out. In this case, I have gunpowder. So the reason I'm doing this recipe is because I need pulverized coal, which is then getting outputted to the side. You see the red box, red output on the right, into this magma crucible. And this magma crucible is turning the pulverized coal into fluid. That fluid, or the liquefacted coal I was telling you earlier, getting pumped into this compressed dynamo, which is using liquefacted coal and water, which is being pumped in, to create energy. Now, real quick, I don't think I covered this one either. I'm sorry. I'm very forgetful. The aqueous Aqueous accumulator. You can put it inside of an infinite water source, or in this case, I have one block of water to the left, one block on the right, and it acts as an infinite water source because the block in the middle will constantly replace itself, and it will automatically draw water and pump it out. So it acts as an infinite water source, but for machinery, and so it'll pump water out. In this case, I've got it being pumped into the dynamo. So, anyways. So, magma crucible into portable tank into dynamo. Decided I have this energy cell, just collecting energy and pumping it out, storing it for whatever's excess, because I do not like waste. And since I am having to compress, or not compress, pulverize coal, it has an output, or a secondary output, of sulfur. And so I found a recipe that used sulfur. You can use sulfur to make gunpowder. But it too required pulverized coal. So that's why there's two pulverizers getting pumped out. You saw a sulfur icon right there. Sulfur is getting drawn from both of these into that cache, which is then getting drawn over here into the assembler. From there, we also have another pulverizer and a cyclic assembler. Now what this one is doing is it is taking sandstone and pulverizing the sandstone. Now what you can do, now when you pulverize sandstone, it has an output of nitre, which is used in that recipe for gunpowder. So what I've got this thing doing is it's taking sandstone, pulverizing it, taking the nitre, pumping it over to this cache, which is then getting pumped to that assembler. But it also, when you pump out sandstone, or when you pulverize sandstone, it gives you sand. So over here, I have a schematic. It takes four sand, creates another sandstone, puts it back in there. So sort of a self, you know, refueling system. But it's not a perfect system because pulverizing sandstone gives you two pieces of sand, and it requires four to make it. So you're losing 50%. But still, you're also getting the nitre, which is getting pumped over there. So nitre is getting pumped in over here. There's not much in here. I'm going to take all this stuff out. Yeah, it has a lower chance than the sulfur and then the pulverized coal, and so that's why there's not much in there. But let's see how much I have been able to accumulate. I have three stacks plus 18, so there we go. So it's just been sitting here creating gunpowder for me. But so there's an idea of how you can use thermal expansion for automation, for customization, and just all kinds of cool stuff. I hope this was very beneficial for you. If it is, leave a like down below, leave a comment if you have any questions. I have very few people commenting and saying anything, so I usually respond to any questions I get. You can view some of my other tutorials and check it out. And so, feel free, don't be shy. I will try and do what I can to help. But I hope you enjoyed, and I hope you learned something. Thank you, and I hope you all have a wonderful day.